about. So when you put together regulations, handicaps with respect to infrastructure generally, and the question of paperwork, so this is the time it takes to make transactions, then this is the cost that you are really imposing on exporters as well as on importers.
I see the anti-corruption fight as a number one focus for lesser developed nations to concentrate on. Examples of countries where anti-corruption agencies are functioning at the moment well are like Chile, Costa Rica and Uruguay. They've got better records of healthier private sectors because of it and consequently are increasing their exports. In some countries I've worked, a government has what they call economic police. These are the gentlemen who, unannounced, will invade your premises, hold the works, and then proceed to investigate. Most of the infrastructures in South America and African countries are weakening. Roadworks are dilapidating rapidly. And in a big 4x4, it has taken me over 3 hours of potholes and dust to travel 60 kilometers. Improvement on infrastructure is essential. The tremendous incomes these have created have not always been spent wisely. They increase the cost of living, they inflate the cost of living, reduce the entrepreneurial spirit in the private sector. They usually benefit a few people only and do nothing for the population as a whole. And furthermore, they often foster illegal and abusive practices such as vigorous black markets and child labor, etc. It's no suggestion, but wouldn't it be wonderful, a wonderful world, if governments would spend wisely on education, research, communication, and health? In conclusion, I would like to say that education and training are key to developing a competitive edge to the private sector in these developing countries. Government needs to recognize and encourage the development of a vigorous private sector, from income generating among the very poor people, through small local businesses, through medium enterprises, up to the large corporate undertakings at the national level. Private enterprise adds value to products, and it is these value-added products that ensure profitability in the future export market.
And, you know, you take an example of just one country, just to pick on one among many, the recently established Republic of Montenegro, which is 600,000 people, has a great opportunity through to further grow through trade, and has a good growth rate. It's above the average in Southeast Europe, it's 6% growth, low inflation, it has an excellent and fast business registration for new companies, low corporate tax rate of 9%, lowest in Southeast Europe. And it has a negative trade deficit, which is also linked to a series of factors on non-tariff barriers which do not allow it to further develop intra-regional trade in its region and also exports to Europe. It has, for example, sanitary and phytosanitary standards, which sometimes are not in line even with the EU ones. So it will require additional inspections for products that have been certified by the EU. You will not have enough inspectors at the borders for products coming through, sanitary, phytosanitary products. And we see, before looking at having a proactive trade policy or focusing too much on the whole notion of export promotion, which is the demand generation part, you need to work on the plumbing.
Mon pays est un pays essentiellement agricole. Et la plupart des pays vers lesquels il exporte ses produits exigent généralement et entre autres la conformité de ces produits à leurs règlements sanitaires et phytosanitaires nationaux. Pour un réel développement des importations des pays de développement, il convient de définir clairement les normes internationales, de mettre en place des mesures adéquates visant à garantir la transparence, l'ouverture et l'impartialité des procédures d'élaboration des normes internationales. de tenir compte des besoins de l'Afrique en matière de programmes d'assistance technique et de financement visant à renforcer les capacités au niveau de la production, du conditionnement et de la commercialisation de leurs marchandises.
Yes, we need a change from government, we need the politicians, but let's look at it with a different view.
This is beyond Parliament, it's really important to ensure consultation with all stakeholders. So we're talking about unions and private sector representatives who could be specifically stakeholders who might be affected by the reforms, who could block that reform. And the earlier on the consultations, and the more they're genuine, the more effective governments can be in pushing through the reforms. It's also necessary to make sure that the reforms are good, that the policy that has been developed actually makes sense, which is, again, it's overlooked, but has the good impact and the regulatory impact analysis been conducted? Can it be proven that this policy is actually going to lead to positive results for society?
Visant à favoriser la formalisation du secteur informel. Cette formalisation permettrait de rassurer les investisseurs et autres partenaires commerciaux internationaux. La seconde priorité que nous avons identifiée concerne le renforcement des capacités des associations des femmes entrepreneurs afin d'en faire de véritables institutions d'appui au commerce. La formation contribuerait à améliorer l'environnement des affaires. La troisième priorité a assisté à favoriser l'accès des technologies de l'information et de la communication.